The original Salem's Lot from 1979 was an instant classic. And you know what that means. It made a lot of money. So it was inevitable that years later it was going to be remade. Can lightning strike twice? Is Salem's Lot from 2004 any good or better than the original miniseries? Let's find out. Well, they went with the same TV movie approach, this time by TNT, and split it into two 1.5 hour long sections. It starts out in Detroit, the big city contrasting the small town of Salem's Lot, which in this movie it still goes by its original name of Jerusalem's Lot. Anyway, Ben Mears, played by Rob Lowe, is at a food kitchen. And apparently, he doesn't like the food because he attacks the priest serving it to him. They fight a bit until eventually they both fall out a window and are rushed to a hospital. The nurse there is pretty upset with Ben for trying to kill what seems like an innocent man of the cloth. But maybe there's more to it. Ben convinces the nurse to listen to his story.
Jerusalem's.
Now, we're introduced to Larry Crockett, the real estate mongrel who is the richest person in town. Ben meets with him because he's renting the Marston House while he stays here. Like in the original, Ben is an author and he's writing about something. At first, we're led to believe that he's writing about the house, but we soon learn that there's more to it. Ben has a history with the Marston house. He went inside on a dare and found Hubie Marston and his wife dead. This is similar to the original, but there it sounded more like Ben saw Marston's ghost, not his dead body. Anyway, he can't get the house because there's a problem. It's already been purchased. Crockett went back on his deal with Ben to sell it to Richard Straker and his partner Barlow, who, like in the original, open an antique shop in town. I don't remember Charlie Rhodes from the original. Here he's a strict bus driver that doesn't take any of the kids' crap. If you even so much make a peep, he's gonna kick you off the bus.
You got a lot to talk about?
And that's just what happens to the Tibbet boys, Danny and Ralphie, and Mark Petrie. So they're forced to walk home, I guess. Matt Burke is the town's English teacher. In the original, it was Jason Burke. I'm not really sure why they changed the name, but okay. Matt is played by Andre Braugher, who plays in another Stephen King movie, The Mist, but also Brooklyn Nine-Nine. The only other notable thing they mention is that Matt is a closet homosexual, which in a small town in 2004 would have made sense that he's still in the closet. We also meet Susan here as well. Her family owns the diner, so she's working here until she can make it as an artist. There's also Dudley, a guy who walks with a limp, Ruth Crockett, Larry's daughter and Dudley's crush, Mike, who works at the dump this time and not as a grave digger, Floyd Tibbetts, Susan's ex, who works with Mike, Eva Pruninger, Weasel, Sheriff Parkins, Dr. James Cody, Sandy McDougall. Jeez! Think that's enough characters? But remember, this is 3 hours long, and we're just getting started. A lot happens in this movie. Larry meets with Straker at the antique shop and asks him if he can get a couple of guys and pick up a very important crate and have it delivered to his house. The two guys Larry hires is Mike and Floyd, who do the job well. They deliver the crate, to the old Marston house, look around a little bit, but get spooked, and then book it out of there. The next day, Dudley's doing his job picking up trash, and they get to the Crockett household. He sees Ruth in the window, and Larry isn't happy about it at all. Larry calls Mike and threatens to close all of his accounts unless he fires Dudley. And seeing how Mr. Crockett owns half the town, that would be a lot of lost business. with his hand being forced, Mike has to let his friend go. Mark, Danny, and Ralphie go to Charlie Rhodes' house and break onto his bus. But they get spotted, so they take off into the woods, and Mark gets separated from the brothers. They see a light in the woods and just pray that it's Mark. But we know better. This is Straker. The boys cross a frozen pond, but Ralphie gets caught. And how does this masked assailant decide to take him out? By putting him under the ice to drown him. Brutal. Danny sees all this, but there's nothing he can do. Later on, Father Callahan finds Danny in the middle of the road passed out and takes him to his parents.
You better call an ambulance.
At the hospital, Dr. Coote looks at Danny and can tell he's in shock and assures the family that he will be okay. Then moves on to his next patient, a baby. And Dr. Coote has the hots for his mom. But she's married. So this is our affair of the movie. In the original, it was between Crockett and his secretary. There it worked quite well. You didn't know if the husband was going to shoot Crockett. It was a crime of passion. But here, it's just a crime. The husband and wife are trying to scam the doctor out of money. $10,000 to be exact. When the husband catches them in the sack, he makes his demands and tells the doctor he has one day to get him that money. Meanwhile, at the dump, Dudley is still pretty upset with his friend for firing him. He's out there feeling bad for himself when he gets some company. Barlow. In this movie, and in the book, he's just a normal-looking dude, but still just as evil as in the first. Barlow offers to help Dudley, to take away his limp and give him eternal life. Being teased his whole life for his disability, Dudley happily accepts.
What were you to say if I gave you a chance to be equal to those boys and girls? Or maybe even a little more?
Back in the hospital, Danny wakes up to see his brother on the other side of the plastic curtain. But he still must be invited in. Not quite as effective as floating outside his window and scratching on the glass, but still creepy in its own way. Danny invites Ralphie in, and later, the doctors find him sucked dry. Ben, Matt, and Susan all meet up for dinner and get to talking about the Marston house. We learn that when he was alive, kids would go missing. When he died, that all stopped. Was he a serial killer, or was something else going on? Ben finally reveals the plot of his book.
No.
It's not a work of fiction about the haunted Marston house,
what do you mean?
But a non-fiction book about the evil people who live in the small town.
So we're evil.
Susan doesn't take that too kindly, thinking that she was more to Ben than just some character in his book, and she storms off. Now on to Danny Glick's funeral, which, like in the original, is a pretty somber affair. But this time, it's Danny's dad who has the meltdown, not his mother. Anyway, after the ceremony, Mike goes to bury him, and he's lured into the ground by the vampire's trance. He yells because he knows Danny's eyes are open. We don't see the attack, but we get what's going on. Matt sees Mike at Norton's and assumes he's high on something, until Mike says he passed out while burying Danny, and he had a strange dream. Now, Matt knows what's going on, and he offers him a place to stay for the night. Mike settles in, and it's obvious that Matt is pretty attracted to his new guest. He takes off his shirt, and Matt sure is tempted, but he sees a giant bruise. Must have been some fight. Later that morning, Matt hears something in the other room. Worried that Mike is now a vampire, he calls Ben over to help him out. When they go in, he looks pretty bad, and there's a single drop of blood on his blanket. Matt notices that the bruise is also gone, but Mike is dead in Matt's house. Now, they've got some explaining to do. They call the cops, and Dr. Coote comes over and checks on Mike. When he shines a light into his eyes, his pupils dilate, which freaks him out, but apparently that can happen to a dead body? I don't know, I'm no doctor. But for now, Matt's off the hook for Mike's death. Later that night, Susan is over at Matt's visiting when they hear something coming from the room Mike died in. He goes up slowly as to not alert whoever is in there, hitting every squeaky floorboard as he goes. When he opens the door, surprise, it's Mike, and he tempts Matt, knowing his deepest secret. But Matt knows better. He knows that Mike is dead, and when he looks in the mirror, he figures it out for himself. Matt revokes his invitation to his house and is really struggling with Mike's vampirism curse. I guess I'd be freaking out too if I just learned vampires are 100% real. Mike flies out the window and Matt passes out, having a heart attack. While all this is going on, Ben is still unpacking his things. As he walks to the truck, he's attacked by a bundled up Floyd. Yeah. I forgot to mention that earlier, Floyd was attacked by Dudley, so he's a vampire now too, which results in both of them going to jail for the night. In there, Floyd talks to Ben through a vent. He knows his deepest, darkest secrets and brings back some of the memories of what he found in the Marston house when he went in. Then, Floyd breaks his bones and squeezes into the tiny vent to get to Ben. This is just about the only bad use of CGI in the movie, and it does look pretty goofy. Going through all that trouble of shoving himself into the hole, Floyd must still be invited in, which Ben just simply won't do. So he's safe for the night, and released the next morning. Floyd, however, is dead. He slit his wrist and drank his own blood. Finally, the first part of this two-part miniseries ends with Mark Petrie and his visit from his dead friend Danny. He scratches at his window trying to get in, and Mark gets up, grabbing a cross from his model as he walks to the window. He lets Danny in, and as he attacks, he shoves the cross into his old friend, which makes him fly away. And that's the end of part one. It shows Ben back in the hospital telling his story to the nurse, whose shift is over, but he's so enthralled that he decides to stick around and listen to the rest of the story. What do you think so far of this version of Salem's Lot? Want to see how it ends? Stay tuned, and we'll get to that next.